using it to fight against Israel. They were using the infrastructure as their command center and intelligence center. They had special technological equipment in the building, which they used to actively fight and disrupt Israeli actions. And as such, it is a, as you said in the beginning, we deem it to be a legitimate military target, and out of consideration for human life and for the people who work there, we chose to forfeit additional military gains by surprise attacking, and instead, we did what of course is the right thing to do, advanced warning and allowed everybody to clear, vacate the premises, and made sure that everybody were out before the building was struck.
Can you show us the evidence? Can you hold it up? Can you show us the pictures, the intelligence you have?
That's in process, and I'm sure that in due time that information will be presented. So
far, shouldn't that have happened 24 hours ago?
Again, we've said very clearly what's in the building, and again, like the opening statement said, let's have a more nuanced and comprehensive view at what's going on here. It's not as
right,
if
but
this
if you all knew Hamas was in the building and you're about to bomb a news bureau, you could have provided the evidence an hour or two later.
Well, it's not about bombing a news bureau. It's about the fact that Hamas systematically uses civilian infrastructure for their military purposes. And our assessment is that this time Hamas thought that AP and Al Jazeera and a few other smaller outlets would render them safe against any Israeli attack. That's probably the way Hamas thinks, just like they think when they plan rocket attacks and when they place rocket launchers next to hospitals and next to schools and when they dig tunnels underneath their own homes. It's exactly the same.
Journalists as human shields is a very, very concerning thing. However, the Associated Press says it had no idea. It's never been told. Why didn't Israel inform the AP and Al Jazeera ahead of time if you're saying Hamas intelligence units were in the same building as their bureaus?
Again, there's an issue here of a military objective. The objective here was to deny the enemy military capabilities. We choose to win less in terms of, we choose to gain less, militarily speaking, by giving advance warning. Had we not warned, then we would have been able to strike additional pieces of equipment and hardware and facilities that Hamas and the Islamic Jihad uses. That's why there was an advance warning of about an hour. Which is a good enough time for people to vacate, but the aim here was to hit a military target that Hamas and Islamic Jihad used in combat against us.
Israel has abilities to have pinpoint attacks to take out one room and one floor of one building. Why level the entire building? Were you trying to send a message to the media in Gaza?
Not at all. We operate freely, we allow access, we interact daily with the media, hourly, every minute. So that is not the case.
Well, let me show you what Al Jazeera is saying. And I recognize Al Jazeera is funded by Qatar. Qatar has close ties with Palestine. Let me show you the statement from Al Jazeera saying the destruction of this tower is a blatant violation of human rights and is internationally considered a war crime. That's the statement from Al Jazeera. Your reaction?
Well, I think that they're wrong, and I think that whoever wrote that statement doesn't know enough about the law of armed conflict. Once infrastructure for military purposes, for fighting, it qualifies as a military target. And if you strike, we, as the military, if we strike with proportional force causing minimal collateral damage, and you said so yourself, nobody was even injured, because we made sure nobody was injured, then that is a strike that is acceptable when you are fighting against a terrorist organization.
Two more questions for you. The Jerusalem Post reports that Israeli intelligence has presented the intelligence to the United States, that the Biden White House knows about this intelligence. Can you confirm that report in the Jerusalem Post?
Unfortunately, I cannot. I don't know what they based that report on. I know that there are very extensive ties, of course, between us and the U.S., the entire defense establishment. But at this time,
what about a timeline? Sir, what about a timeline for the proof that you say will be provided? Today, tomorrow?
No, I cannot commit to that either. I don't know. I know that you know we're in the middle of fighting here. Our civilians are being bombarded by, up until now, 2,900 rockets. We have 9 dead Israeli civilians, 1 dead soldier. The country is under constant, relentless bombardment. Civilians are in shelters. 5-6 million Israeli civilians are in shelter almost the entire day. So yes, it's very important, and I understand that many people are very concerned about it. I am sure that Israeli officials will get to it as soon as possible, but at now, the order of the day is to beat Hamas and to overcome the military challenges that are life-threatening for our civilians.
I wonder, broadly speaking, if you feel like Israel's losing the media war, losing the media or losing the propaganda war right now.
Let me tell you this. I think that Hamas is getting a free ride. And I'll give you an example. Most of the international outlets, they rely on figures for casualties in Gaza based on one single source, the Gaza Health Ministry. Guess who runs the Gaza Health Ministry? Hamas does. Hamas has an interest in enlarging the amount of non-combatants, women, children, etc., allegedly killed in combat, while they have an inherent interest in making all of those 20 to 30-year-old men who are part of their fighting force disappear out of their lists. And I think that's a very convenient strategy. And I think that too many people, too many news outlets are taking their word for granted, and they're making us go through very hard scrutiny. And I think it should be the other way around, actually.
There are questions about your credibility. Let's put back up on screen those examples, these headlines from the past 48 hours about what happened when spokespeople for the IDF said that it was a ground invasion, that an invasion of Gaza was happening. Then the story changed. There was no such invasion. You can see there the headline, Israeli military accused of using the media to trick Hamas. What happened, Lieutenant Colonel?
You used the term which I'm about to use. You said it, fog of war. It's human to make mistakes. We make mistakes, and as soon as we understood that that a mistake was made, I corrected it, and we're moving on.
You're moving on, but I think many journalists are very suspicious of what happened. They feel like they were tricked. They feel like they were used. How are you going to regain trust, rebuild trust?
Well, you know, we've been through this at length with lots of people. We've explained ourselves. I've explained myself. My seniors have done it. We've even issued an official letter to the head of the Foreign Press Association explaining what happened. And again, emphasizing how important it is for us to be able to gain and maintain the trust of international media and Israeli media, our commitment to unbiased, fair and true information. That is what I've been doing for my last 4 years here in the job. That's what I will continue to do. And I think that mistakes are part of the business, and it's part of the environment. It is a very chaotic, dynamic environment. And sometimes small bits of information have great importance. This was an unfortunate such occurrence.
That's certainly true. I appreciate that you are here and willing to take the questions. It is an incredibly complicated media environment as well as a geopolitical environment. As we are speaking, I'm getting a story across the wire about six Israeli police officers injured when a car slammed into a police checkpoint. You know, what would sound like an attack, although we don't have all the details yet. So every hour you must be getting more and more information, sometimes conflicting information, and trying to keep up with it like the rest of us.
Yeah, not only that. I mean, we have rocket attacks from Lebanon, from Syria the last few days. We've had lots of unrest and rioting in Judea and Samaria. This event now in Jerusalem, which is, of course, potentially very escalating. And there is definitely a lot going on. But again, our focus here, and, you know, too much talk is about the less relevant parts. Let's go back to what really matters. What really matters is safety of ours, from our point of view. What really matters is safety of our civilians and the fact that for 7 days, our country is under fire. And so many people around the world find it acceptable, and they expect us to find it acceptable, that our civilians are bombarded,